Welcome to Hindu Analysis, August 28, 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. The first article is Indus Water Treaty talks to begin tomorrow. So the news is India and Pakistan is going to have its 115th meeting in Lahore on Indus Water Treaty, which was previously passed. So what this Indus Water Treaty is that we are going to see later. So first, what they are going to discuss in the meeting, in that Indus Water Treaty meeting at Lahore, is these are the major discussions. So the first major discussion between India and Pakistan is first the hydroelectric projects, which is being carried out by India on the Chenab River, which is under construction in Jammu and Kashmir. So what are the two major projects? Is one is a 1000 megawatt capacity Pahaldal, and the second one is 48 megawatt Lower Kalnai. So these two are the hydroelectric projects which is being carried out by India on the Chenab River in Jammu and Kashmir. And also this raises a major concern among Pakistan, and they are objecting to further continue or resume these two projects. So that is what the major discussion it will be on. Like, the Pakistan is actually objecting these two water storage and hydroelectric projects by India. As well as in this meeting, they're also going to discuss about the sharing of the hydrological data of Indus water system. So if you see in this picture, India is nearly having 20% of Indus river system's governance or under its control, and 80% of the river is under the control of Pakistan. So we all knew that this 1960 Indus Water Treaty was signed between India and Pakistan, and it is a kind of a legal framework which is meant for sharing of water resources and its provisions. And it is a successful one because it is like nearly 56 years since this treaty was getting signed. And now we are going to see what are the provisions of this Indus Water Treaty. So as per the treaty, the Bias, Ravi and Satluj, which are the eastern rivers, this is under the governance of India, and Indus, Chenab as well as the Jhelum, which are the western rivers, they are taken care by the Pakistan government. So this is the major provision under that Indus Water Treaty. As well as, since this Indus River is flows through India, that means this Indus River is originated from Tibet and then it flows through India and then only it reaches Pakistan. So since it flows through India, 20% of the water of the Indus River can be made utilized by India for its irrigation purposes, as well as for the power generation and transport purposes only. So these three are open for India. Nearly about 20% of the water can be make utilized by India for these three purposes. So it is actually, this Indus Water Treaty is signed by the then Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, as well as Pakistan's then President Ayub Khan, and it is brokered or intermediated by World Bank. Okay. So if you see in this picture, this Indus River and Jhelum and Chenab. So these three are the western rivers, and it is under the control of Pakistan. And you see here, right, it is flows from, that means from India to Pakistan. Okay. And similarly, this Ravi River, Bias River and Satluj River, these three are the eastern rivers, and it is under the control of India. So as per the treaty, a permanent Indus Commission was established, and this commission's purpose is to resolve the dispute which is arising between India and Pakistan over the water sharing. And though the Indus originates from Tibet, as of now China has been kept out of this treaty, and only India and Pakistan is under the ambit of this treaty. So what is the way forward here is, now India and Pakistan is going to have its 115th meeting on this Indus Water Treaty, and we are still at loggerheads. That means we are still at some conflicts between both India and Pakistan among the construction, or about the construction of the hydroelectric projects over the Chenab River. But once this treaty was ratified by both these countries, there has been no fight over the water sharing. Only we are having problems on the construction of hydroelectric projects and not on water sharing. So we have to keep in our mind, and we have to make this meeting a meaningful one. So the second article is the economics of nation states. So we all knew that we are having a lot of nations in the world, and each and every nation is having its own border, and this each and every country is separated by strict borders. So why we are having such kind of borders for each and every country? So what is the economical background or economy behind these kind of having borders and having separate nations? So that is what discussed in this article. So if you see here, why we are having the strict borders, because for their governance convenience by each and every government. And if you see, for an example, US can't tax Russian peoples. Similarly, Russia can't tax this US people. because if they forcefully go and tax them, then it is called as an act of aggression. So within their territory, the government which is prevailing there only can put taxation over the people. So historically, if we see, the powerful rulers, they want to be the owner of the entire world. So what these old rulers, what they are actually telling to the people is, we offer you the protection, and as a reciprocation, you just give us the goods as well as you just pay the taxes. So it is a two-way thing, and it should benefit both of us. That is what the old rulers actually aiming at, and this is a kind of strategy which is called market for governance. So for goods and taxes, they are offering them the protection, which ultimately lead to the ownership ambition of the rulers. It is what it actually represents. But over time, everything is getting changed. Now, not any ruler is want to own the entire world or something like that. Now they want to cooperate. So each and every leader is trying to cooperate among themselves to provide the welfare to the people. So if you see today in modern society, the nation states and the government want to not to control entire world, instead it want to control only the specific territories, and they want to provide welfare to that particular territory. They want to put tax over the people in that specific territory and not in the entire world. So why? Because instead of competing against each other like previous in historical times we are fighting each other, so instead of fighting that, if we cooperate, then it can reap more benefits than fighting with each other, and this can yield more revenue than before. So it is called cooperation for governance. Instead of market for governance, now we follow cooperation for governance. So this is the economical fact which is behind the recent or modern nation states. So the next article is, Wuhan spirit should spur national partner India to BRI initiative. So this is what the China's official recently said. So what the content here is, actually CPEC, we all know about this China-Pakistan economic corridor. So the China's official said that this CPEC is an economic initiative, and implementing this CPEC doesn't actually jeopardize China's position on Kashmir, and it in any way it is not going to affect the India's sovereignty. So this is what he recently stated, and he also added that after this informal Wuhan summit, India and China is entered into a new phase of development. And historically, if you see, means India was an important country on the ancient Silk Road. So we are already, India was an important country on the ancient Silk Road, and India was a natural partner itself. So as it is a part of the ancient Silk Road, now it is becoming a natural partner to China, and it is one of the part of the BRI. So this is what the China's officials said. And this natural partner of India to China is actually again re-emphasized after this informal Wuhan summit. This is what the China's official said. And he also added that we never underestimate the capacity of India, because we know that India is a founding member of AIIB Bank, and it is the second largest shareholder of the AIIB Bank, as well as 20% of that bank's project is based in India. So this is what he said about India's participation in that AIIB Bank, as well as he welcomed India and Pakistan to jointly participate in Eurasian counter-terrorism military exercise in order to counter the terrorism and to reduce the terrorist activities under the SCO, which is the Shanghai Cooperation. And it also added, that means the China's official also added that in order to develop or in order to maintain the peace and the stability in the region, what we actually needed is the cooperation should exist between both India and China, India and Pakistan, as well as multilaterally. So she also added that in order to maintain the peace and stability in the region, what we actually needed is there should be a cooperation that should exist between India and China, India and Pakistan, as well as multilaterally also. So both bilaterally as well as multilaterally, there should be a cooperation among all the countries in terms of execution of any projects, including the BRI. So that is what she added. And if you see in this picture, this is a Silk Road belt of land route, and this is sea route or maritime route. Okay, this is the BRI. So the next article is restoring dignity on stigma attached to leprosy. So what the news here is, the people who are getting affected by leprosy, they are also having dignity, they are also having equal rights in the society. So the government as well as the people should come forward in ensuring the dignity of the people who are affected by this leprosy. So law, this article starts like this: the law has been an instrument for a social change, but the law which was enacted before, that itself acts as a place for enabling the discrimination over this leprosy. leprosy people. So if you see this case, Lepers Act of 1898, this act itself actually stimulates the discriminatory in both the law as well as in the society from the beginning itself, which means instead of providing dignity to the leprosy people, now this law actually create some kind of misconception about the diseases, and it excluded that leprosy people from the mainstream people, stating that physical segregation of leprosy people or the physical segregation of the patients is very necessary. So this is a major misconception, but the reality is this disease is not easily communicable, as well as this disease is actually curable. So this is the reality, but this law created a misconception. So that is why the Law Commission put forward some suggestions in order to repeal this Lepers Act 1898. So as per the Law Commission's recommendation, it is actually repealed 2 years ago. So considering the nature of this disease, which means this disease is not communicable as well as it is curable. So considering this nature of disease, exclusion of this patients is actually not relevant as per the today's society. So they actually repealed this 2 years before itself. Though this Lepers Act 1898 has been repealed 2 years before itself, the stigma that is associated with this leprosy people is still maintained in the society. So that is what the major concern. Though the law is actually removed, but the stigma which is associated with the people, that is, these people should be excluded from the society, that stigma is still remains in the society. So for that, now there are two new hopes which is available. One is the bill which is recently introduced in the parliament to remove leprosy as a ground for seeking divorce or legal separation from one spouse. So if a husband or wife is getting affected with this disease, then there should be no seeking of divorce on the ground of this disease. So that is one major thing which is aimed or envisioned in that provision. And the second one is the Supreme Court is also asked to the center that you should create some laws which confer rights as well as the benefits to the persons or the patients, and that this new law which should be enacted by you, that it should not repeal all the acts and rules that perpetuated the stigma, which means the law that is made by you should not perpetuate the stigma, instead it should remove the stigma. That is what the Supreme Court told to the center. So what is the way forward here is, we can possibly remove this discrimination by law, we can remove it by law, but the stigma which is associated, that is what actually we need to remove from the society. So we can easily remove by law, but the people's thought or the people's opinion about these people, that is what we should curb out of the society, and it may require more than just the legal efforts to eliminate this kind of stigma. So behavioral change of the people should be the major driver in ensuring the dignity of these diseased persons. So the next article is ways to read the constitution. That means how can we interpret the constitution? So it suggests that the constitution can be interpreted in two ways. One at the framers' point of view and another one is according to the conventional society. So how we can interpret the constitution? So that is what this article deals with. So we all knew that the recent issue of Sabarimala case, in which the entry of certain age of women into the Sabarimala temple is prohibited. This restriction or this issue raises severe constitutional conflicts, such as it affects the religious freedom of certain groups and it actually influences more gender inequality, as well as the right of the women to worship is prohibited. So these are all the conflicts which is arising due to this Sabarimala issue. And the petitioner who is putting this case in the Supreme Court stated that the discrimination which is now putting over the women is based on the biological reasons, and it is not actually permissible going by the constitutional scheme. If you go as per the constitution, then you should not discriminate anyone based on the biological reason, but you are now doing it for the women, so it is discriminatory. And another one is, so the petitioner also stated that due to this current exclusion of women into the temple, the right of women to worship the deity or the god is actually violated. So these are the points which is put forward by the petitioner. So this is one point of view. So on the other hand, those who are the supporters of such ban, that is the Devastam board as well as the others who are supporting this restriction of women, what they are stating is, this restriction is an age-old custom and it is actually ensured in the constitution itself by means of Article 25 and 26. So what the Article 25 is, if any practice which is followed by any group of people, whether that practice is a essential religious practice, then it is getting importance under this Article 25. So they are stating that this prohibition is an essential religious practice. So if you see this article 26, what it has is, so the matter such as who can enter into the temple and who cannot enter into the temple is usually be determined by the religious institutions. So as per the provision, this restriction of women into the temple can also be decided by the religious institutions itself. So this is what these two things are taken as a justification by the supporters or supporters of the ban. So but whether it should be acceptable or not, so that is another issue. So this article suggests that we all know about Article 17, so it is abolishing that untouchability based on caste system, but the recent Sabarimala issue, that is exclusion of the women into the temple, so that is actually stimulating this kind of untouchability, because this is purely based on the purity as well as the impurity of the women. So this notion of purity impurity classification itself is seen as a untouchability or as a support of untouchability. It is a form of untouchability, that is what they stated, that is the petitioner stated in the Supreme Court while filing. But the supporter of the ban, what they are telling is, this Article 17 actually envisioned or try to protect the interest of only the backward class people. So the intention of Article 17 is to protect the backward class people's interest and not all people. And also the framers of the Constitution, while framing the Constitution or while writing these articles, they never intend or never include women within the ambit of this untouchability. So this is what the supporters stated. And these supporters actually want the Constitution to be stagnant or original constitution itself, whatever the framers' intention, that is to be maintained all over the time. That is what the supporter stated. But the petitioner, what he is telling is, actually our society is evolving, so similarly the constitution should also get evolved and it should not be stagnant. That is what the petitioner suggested. So these are two ways of interpretation, right? So based on the two before arguments, the author stated here that there are two ways or two approaches to interpret the Constitution. One is the original intent approach towards the Constitution. Another one is the living tree doctrine approach, which means in original intent approach, it is purely based on the intent of the framers of the Constitution, what the framers of Constitution think while they were writing the Constitution. So that is what taken into account in this case. But the living tree doctrine, which is very prominent in Canadian jurisprudence, so as per this living tree doctrine, what they are stating is, as the society getting evolved, the constitution or any law that is also should get evolved, that is it should get changed according to the needs of the society. So any constitution should be like a living tree doctrine. That is the second way of approach. So what is the way forward or what is the conclusion here is, the interpretation of any laws or interpretation of constitution should be an evolving one, an organic one, rather than a stagnant one. So that is what the author suggested. And the interpretation of constitution should be based on the needs of the changing society. If the society is evolving, the constitution should also act as a living tree. That is, it should also get evolving. So that is what they suggested in this article. So the last article is how dams can control floods. So we all knew that the dams are usually constructed for three purposes. One is irrigation, power generation, as well as the flood control. But usually the first two roles, which are the irrigation and the power generation, are usually met. But this flood control role is usually underestimated. That is, we are not yet recognized this role of the dams. Why? Because we all knew that the internationally accepted practice, which is the water level of any reservoir or a dam should be kept below a certain level. For example, if it is 100% means, then you should fill water up to only 60% and remaining 40% should be kept empty, so that during the monsoon seasons or during heavy rains, the water can get stored in this 40%. So that is what the internationally accepted practice, but we are not following it properly. So for example, in Thailand, only 60% is the threshold, which means you should maintain a level of 60% of water in the reservoir, so that when the monsoon comes, the water or the excess water should be get stored in that remaining 40% of the reservoirs, in order to prevent the floods downstream when there is a heavy rainfall. So in order to prevent the flood control only, they are actually keeping that much percentage of dams or reservoirs as empty. But in reality, if we see in our country, we are storing excess of water in the reservoirs, because our main intention is towards greater electricity generation as well as the irrigation, and we fail to recognize the important role which is the flood control by the reservoirs. So if we do that properly, that means if we maintain that threshold level of water in the dams, then the excess water could be stored in that remaining area so that we can control the floods, as if which is recently happened in Kerala and all. So what is the conclusion here is, dams are useful. It is an irrefutable fact. It is very much useful. It is true. But extra quantity of electricity generation by means of reservoirs and the extra area of land which is getting irrigated, that is not going to compensate the loss of the human lives, infrastructure loss, as well as the agricultural land loss by means of the floods which is occurring. So we have to balance all these things. We should not focus only on irrigation as well as the electricity. We should turn our focus towards the flood control also. So that is also a main intention of this dams. So that is the intention of the dams. And also, at least we have to ensure that 30% of the storage capacity of the reservoir should be kept free for the storage of excess water during the monsoon season. And the water management policies also should focus on to control floods and not to cause them. So the policy should be efficiently getting implemented. That is also a major way forward. So the another thing is, the government as well as the people should turn their focus towards non-conventional sources of electricity, such as solar power, wind power, as well as the tidal power, so that our over-dependency towards the hydroelectricity can be reduced, and so which led to the reduced amount of water storage in the dams, which in turn reduces the floods.